A feeling of death seems to grip me if I turn my attention anywhere other than to the very heart of the truth. So I'm forced to tape, really. I try to take it easy, and immediately I'm hit with just this horrible inner, like, just like the whole body starts getting just shaking and jittery, like I'm coming apart, unglued, entirely unglued. So I said, wow, I better stay focused. It's a forced focus almost. Really amazing. A lot of progress today in looking at the perfect stalemate, as it were. The perfect no, actually, we experience it as a stalemate, because no has to be no to something. So the something still has to be there, otherwise the no would lose all meaning. So it really is a stalemate. I say it's a stalemate between the dance of formations and the dance of no formations, or no dance, no formations. The stillness of no formations, no dance of formations. And it's a stalemate between these two. Each one says to the other, you can't change me. But now, who is looking at this? Who is aware of it? Okay, that's the question. So in looking at this today, there was a lot of progress. And let me see if I can, we can take a look at it here, because it's crucial. It's crucial. There doesn't have to be a winner. There doesn't have to be a loser. That's not the point. So when you look at the stalemate, what you might first think is, well, how do I break this stalemate? You say, uh-oh. You could react like, oh my gosh, there's this complete stalemate. I'm seeing this. How do I break this stalemate? And then you're trying to figure out, and you say, I can't figure it out. I can't see any way to break the stalemate. And then you might get all freaked out, say, wow, what is this? It scares me. But if you realize that the stalemate is there so that you can see something that is steady and perfect, and this reminds you of reality, in other words, it's there to solve the continuity issue, then you don't freak out. It's a completely different take on it. So you can have two different takes, actually, on it. And those who have the take of needing to break the stalemate will avoid this experience at all costs, because they think they'll be overwhelmed by it. They'll be overwhelmed by difficulty. But if you see that you only need to enjoy the stalemate and abide in this, and in the recognition of this, abide in the recognition of the perfect stalemate, then there's no fear, no upset at all. So it's amazing how this the reactions can differ. And in approaching this, I must be approaching this state, because this is why I'm getting this severe reactions. It is the personality, so to speak, is saying, I feel like I'm going into a death trap, quote unquote, death trap, meaning I can't break the stalemate, as if breaking the stalemate is life. It's not. It would just simply be formations managing to get the unformed starting to form, starting to bubble, getting bubbles in it. And we call that life. We call the dance of formations life. It's not. It's actually death. Or it's a training program for death. It's not really death. It's a training program for death. Which doesn't exist. It's not real. And reality has no death to it. So the personality thinks, how in the world am I going to break this stalemate? And so the voice of reason has to overpower, be stronger than the voice of the personality, and say, no, I don't have to break the stalemate. In fact, I just enjoy it. I just notice it. Just notice it. And in doing so, this automatically begins to dissolve the fear, the continuity fear that we have, automatically. And then at some point, we finally relinquish perception altogether, and both the unformed and the formed go together. They go together. So we don't have to break the stalemate. We don't have to have one overcome the other, so to speak. So the immutable and the mutable, you see them both without trying to figure out which one can get the upper hand. No. So this fear is really a deadly kind of fear, but again, it may be coming from the emergence of this vision. This vision may be emerging within me. It's possible. It's likely, and these reactions are reacting to it, saying, "Oh my gosh, you know, I'm stuck." Although there's stuckness. No, it's stalemateness. It's not stuckness. Stalemateness, as it were, is different. And have to re-evaluate and come to accept that you can accept it just as it is. Don't need to try and change it. You see, it may seem like a problem to us. Thinking, how do I solve this problem? This one's too big for me. It's too difficult. And you're scared. You're going to be overwhelmed and you're going to feel really stupid. No, not at all. Not at all. If you see the context, it's the height of being smart, actually, not stupid. Because the ego would always say, "Well, you got to get that dancing. You got to get the bubbles arising from the unformed." I mean, and you know, if you can't do that, you're stupid and ignorant and incompetent. I said, "Whoa, wait a minute here. Wait just a minute." Yeah. So, the egoic attitude, that's what's all shaky, saying, "My gosh, how can we, it seems like we're running up against a wall. We cannot do anything about it." And to the ego, that may seem like death. Well, it's the death of the ego. It's not death, but I mean, it's the end of the ego's claims, basically. It exposes the ego's lies, which is, the ego's made out of lies. So you might say it's the end of the ego. It's really the end of lies. Human beings, it's just spirit pretending to not be divine. That's all. It's a ridiculous pretense, except we've gotten so used to this pretense, we're afraid to stop pretending. So we need this solution the Holy Spirit gives us. No formation. Equal vision. No specialness. No concentration that we call life. We call life a concentration of something, whatever it may be. Concentration of something. As opposed to concentration of something else. So... But now what the Holy Spirit gives us is this equal spreading, like oil, you know, just equally spread out with no concentration anywhere, so to speak. They call the one that sees this the Christed one. Christ means oil. So in other words, the one that is seeing this covering of oil over the whole universe. It's a metaphor for this non-formation of energy. Energy in a non-formation state. No formations arising. So, when one sees this and can accept it, then there is this different state of bliss, I would say. So this is what the reason is telling me. And then the personality reactions are like super jittery. So I have to calm these reactions down, because it seems like this something is emerging, and I can't stop it. And then also there's a reaction of the personality upon seeing it, saying, "Oh wow, okay, I better now go back and figure out how to overcome this." Whereas the right reaction is to say, ah, this is just for me to resolve the continuity problem. So all I have to do is pay attention to it. That's it. You don't need to push it aside and say, okay, let me work on this problem. It's not a problem. It's not a problem. So you either see it as a problem or not a problem. If you see it as not a problem, you're saved. If you see it as a problem, you're not saved. You're back into the damned condition of having the continuity issue, being saddled with that. We're like a horse or a mule with a saddle on us, and something's riding us. And what's riding us is the continuity issue, fear of losing sense of identity and continuity and all that. It's the boss. It's bossing us around. But in seeing the stalemate as not a problem but a solution, it's the end to that being bossed around by the continuity issue. Because you can always look and say, hey ego, you're not having any effect at all on this, this other side of the coin. No effect at all. You have no effect. What are you talking about? What are you bragging about? Saying that you can do this. You can't do anything about this. And the ego will say, well, I will. I say there's no evidence of that. The ego, of course, all ego will always say, well, it's coming. You need to get ready for it. Get ready for it. It's coming. I say, no, it looks like this is a complete stalemate of all formations. So whatever formation you throw at it, it's not going to do anything at all. So when you say it's coming, in what? In formations? That's the only thing that you could be talking about. And it's having zero, all formations are having zero effect on it right now. So your claim that there's going to be some special formation that is going to work is highly dubious, Nothing to back that up whatsoever except just a boast. Zero evidence. It's just blind faith. It'd be just blind faith. And you say, he said, by that time, ego, the continuity problem will be solved, that's your history. So the perfection of the stalemate must be so profound that the evidence it tips the scale in favor of the Holy Spirit and away from the ego. The ego will call this, losing your mind. No, the egoic mind is losing the battle, is what it is. The egoic, the plausible, logical plausibility that the ego touts as reason, has lost the battle. So the ego will say, well, you've lost your mind. You're not even using it to try and figure anything out. So you don't need to. Don't need to use the mind that way. We're just using it to notice a fact. And of course, what's reality but facts? Reality is a fact. So certainly that reminds us of reality, being aware of a fact. Instead of a boast, the ego's boast that it's going to be able to stir up that non-formation energy in it with no special, no formations at all, no specialness, no concentration at all, accumulation, concentration, nothing. Well, what do we call these life forms we have? They're constantly accumulating, right? The oyster accumulating, taking stuff in, accumulating, building up. Builds up the pearl, put a little grain of sand in there. Builds up its shell. Everything is accumulating, concentrating. Concentrations, a tree, what is a tree? It's concentrating various, gases and water and light and minerals, etc. Concentrates it into various forms of concentration that we say is matter. We call that life, but those are just formations. And the activity is the dance of these formations. That's the activity of constantly concentrating stuff. Concentrating, concentrating. Our hair is like a concentration of what? Keratin or something. It's just, these are all just concentrations. And we define that and say that's life. Whereas we'll see, the Holy Spirit shows us energy in a non-concentrated way. Superimposed together with all the concentrations. Now, are all the concentrations arising out of that energy? No, that's not true. They're not arising out of that. They're arising out of imagination, out of desire. But they're not arising out of the perfect non-formation. It's like you might say there's an ocean that's still, and there's an ocean that it has waves. And you're seeing both. But the ocean that has waves cannot produce any waves in the ocean that has no waves. And you don't have to choose between the two. You just say, there's a fact. This is a fact. One has waves, the other has no waves. The one with waves cannot produce waves in the other. And it may be in meditation people are trying to experience this stillness, this calmness, in order to then contrast it with the external activity and be able to get a sense of the stalemate, like there's something that is cannot be moved, as it were. Nirvana without movement. It's just seeing nirvana, but it's open-eyed. In other words, you see the non-moving and the moving. But you see that the moving is not moving the non-moving. Our samadhi, open-eyed samadhi, is the way. We're not talking about going into samadhi or nirvana. We're talking about open-eyed samadhi, open-eyed nirvana. Is simply seeing the non-moving and the moving, both two sides of one coin, and just say that there's a stalemate there. Neither one gets rid of the other. The unmoving doesn't get rid of the moving. It's still moving. The universe is still moving. But the moving of the universe doesn't get rid of the unmoving. It's a stalemate. And then you realize that it will always be a stalemate. There's no resolution. This is just how it is now. And you gradually come to accept this stalemate. And the perfect fact of it, there's this perfect stalemate that automatically will remind us of reality in the perfection of reality. There's no exception to it. See, in this world of formations, in the formation moving, it seems like there's exceptions to everything. Whatever is always changing. Whatever seems to be is always changing. Whereas in this stalemate, there's not a change in the stalemate. Stalemate is not changing. You have a world that is constantly changing. World of impermanence is constantly changing. But you're contrasting that. You see a plenum that is unmoved, unchanging. And you say, wow, the impermanent, all constant changing is not changing this. Put you in a different state of mind, absolutely. The boast that anything can be changed is exposed as a boast, because this unchanging plenum is not being changed. So the ego, of course, it's our attempt to change reality, really. And the mind is showing us evidence that everything can be changed. But yeah, we see this plenum, the fullness. Now, speaking of a plenum, the ego might say, there's nothing there. Because there's no change. You know, ego says change is something. Change is life. And ego says there's nothing there. Well, that's like saying that you have like an ocean of gold, shining, beautiful gold. And somebody is making some rings out of this gold and has a shop full of these rings. And somebody's looking at the rings saying, oh, I love these rings. And then they look at the ocean and say, there's nothing there. There's nothing there. There's no rings there. What's up? No, The gold is an ocean full of gold. It's just that the ring, just because the plenum is not going into any formations, doesn't mean there's nothing there. It's completely full, just like an ocean of gold or an ocean of light, you know. So it's not like there's nothing there. It's just there's no formations there, made out of, you know, no bubbles arising, so to speak. And our culture is going towards making excuses about not focusing on this question. That's what I found. It's a culture of excuses. That is the way to look at it. And I'll tell you this, a culture of excuses is no culture at all. So what we're really heading toward is no culture. No culture. We think we're heading toward culture. We trumpet all this stuff, you know, that we're doing, but we're headed toward no culture. And I know people are feeling that, saying, wait a minute, something isn't right here. Because it's simply, everyone is now just learning all these excuses about why they are not focusing on salvation, the message of salvation. Why are they not focused? Everyone has an excuse, many excuses. Their whole life is dedicated to presenting excuses and then calling that culture. There's no culture at all. So who wants no culture at all? No, nobody really wants that. We want a culture. A culture is founded on taking responsibility, actually, for your focus. And when you take responsibility for your focus, and you stop giving your responsibility over to some authority, you know, some political authority, some authority that tells you, you don't have, we'll make an excuse for you. We'll give you an excuse. You need, you know, people say, no, I can't do it because I need to pay attention to what they're saying. You know, it's an excuse. That's no culture. Culture, it comes from individuals saying, I will take responsibility for my focus. And I will try to make the focus as responsible as I can. And then that automatically starts opening up to consideration, and then to contemplation, to clarity, to satsang, to inquiry, all this stuff. It automatically, your attention automatically goes there. And that is true culture. And we're going to no culture. So there have been those who can go into nirvana, can touch upon this plenum. But the real goal is again to see the plenum and the dance of formations together, right? You know, side by side, and see the stalemate there. That's the goal. So open-eyed samadhi, open-eyed nirvana. You know, but people have made a big deal about this in the past, like, oh, very few get to that and stuff. It's because the approach has been, the context has not been explained properly. You know, forget about nirvana. You want both together, you know. You want to see that vision. You don't want to just abide in the plenum, as it were, because that doesn't really solve the continuity problem. You want to have going about your daily, whatever you're doing, and being aware of the plenum, the unmoving, along with the moving and the ever-changing. And you see both. You see both. Aware of both. And you see the stalemate. One doesn't change the other. I mean, there's the chain, that which insists that it could change everything is not changing the plenum. And you just notice it. You just notice it. That's all. It's no big deal. The ego's made a big deal about it, you know. And so it's mystified us. But it's time to get past all that mystification and just, you know, it's a matter of fact, pragmatic thing is all it is. Just pure pragmatism. It's not really a state to be attained. It is simply, is simply you are noticing this, that the planet is not being changed. You're just noticing a fact, that's all. And that gives rise to bliss. But it, you know, you don't want to try to attain bliss. You're not trying to attain bliss. You're trying to see this fact, because you want the continuity problem to be solved. That's the real goal. The goal is not nirvana, samadhi, any of that stuff. It's to solve the continuity problem. Because you don't want to just abide in samadhi or nirvana. No, because that's just the lesser. You know, it's not the ultimate goal. It's really not the goal. The goal is to set down perception altogether by having the continuity problem solved, so you have no fear of setting down perception. Perceiving the unmoving is still perception. Perceiving nirvana, samadhi, the unchanging, the unmoving, that's still perception. It's still perception. So it doesn't solve the continuity problem. The continuity problem is solved by seeing the stalemate. You're seeing all the familiar forms, everything familiar is there, and at the same time, you're seeing it is not capable of changing this, and this is perfect stalemate that neither side will ever change the other, so to speak, and this gives rise to a sense of reality, reminds us of the perfection of reality. Nothing can change it. It can't be changed at all. But by seeing all our dreams, our imagination, unable to change this plenum, that reassures us of the fact of reality. So, just jump right over samadhi and nirvana. Don't even worry about all those meditative states. I need to get into this state or that state, etc., etc. That's the old traditional way. But what I'm trying to do is pivot the entire situation, certainly in the future, towards simply much more streamlined approach, where you say no, the open-eyed samadhi is the goal. It's simply noticing a fact. It's not a try to attain some state. It is just simply understanding the purpose of this. There's a purpose for it. It's not an end in itself. It's actually a remedy. It's like a medicine that we take. So it's a remedy for the continuity issue. And so when these fears arise, then we know where they're coming from. We can talk about them. And saying, yeah, we're afraid of going into the stalemate. How do we break the logjam? How do we, you know? And we don't. We appreciate it. But then the ego will say, but you're going to lose life, because now, you know, you don't have full, you're not getting the full experience of life, because you say, no, these formations are not life. Impermanence is not life. God did not create life as something impermanent, subject to change. So the ego is making all sorts of objections, saying, "Hey," and you can look at them directly and dispel these objections and recognize where they're coming from. So really, if you look at the history of spirituality, it's the ego duping us, because the ego says, "Hey, I mean, I don't think you can reach this state of samadhi, or I don't think you can reach this meditative state. That's an incredible state. That's gonna undo me." And then people say, "Oh, really? Let me see if I can reach this state." So the ego is constantly presenting all these other conditions, and acting as if this is gonna defeat the ego entirely. And so people then jump into those efforts towards that. But it never tells you to just simply accept the open-eyed samadhi, the stalemate, the perfect stalemate. No, it doesn't say that. It says, oh, that can only be reached after all the other states are reached first. What is that? That's delay. That is just delay. It's all it is. The ego, again, is the master of delay. So it tells you, yeah, you need to go through those states. And I guess the real true spiritual teachers will sometimes take you know, in traditional structure, take their devotees through all these meditative states, and after each one, the teacher will say, well, you don't really need that one. You know, and go to the next, and then you really don't need that one, go to the next. Because the devotees under the spell of the ego thinking that these are they need these attainments. They don't need those attainments. And the ego will say, where's your resume? You know, where are your attainments? You haven't done this and this and this and this. How can you do the open-eyed samadhi? Who do you think you are? How pretentious of you. No, it's just the opposite. How pretentious of the ego to think that these other situations resolve the continuity issue when they don't. They don't. We don't need those other states first. Not at all. It's just it's a delaying tactic of the ego. So really, the real spiritual teachers, they know this. And so, you know, the student reaches this incredible samadhi, and then they think that they've got it. And then the teacher says, that's nothing, throw it away. They go, why are you crazy? And at that time, usually they leave the teacher. Yeah. Because they say, teacher, I reached the ultimate. And then you say, throw it away. You're crazy. You're a liar. You're a deceiver. The ego is furious because, you know, the ego doesn't want you to get to that stalemate, to see the stalemate. And again, stalemate takes two to tango. It wants you just to focus on maybe just the inner quiet or inner peace or something. It doesn't want you to see that this impermanence cannot do anything to the, you know, this quiet, still plenum can't do anything to it. It doesn't want you to see that. Because that really undoes the continuity issue, and that's it. That's curtains for the ego. So the ego loves to have you chase after these states of consciousness, as it were, various states, to prevent you from doing what you really need to do, which is really easier than reaching the other state. It's just that we don't try it, because we keep listening to the lies of the ego telling us. The ego says, that won't do anything. That'll just make you crazy. You'll be like, you feel dead. You'll be death. What are you talking about? It's crazy. These other things, these really are it. But those are all lies of the ego. And so we don't try. And the ego tells us, well, see, it's too difficult. But I always say, what do you mean it's too difficult? I've never even tried. You've told me never, don't try it. You know, I've never even tried. What are you talking about? How do we know it's difficult? We just assume it, because that's the ego has set everything up to make it seem that way. All the religious traditions, et cetera, set up to make it seem like what we really need to do is, like, you know, just incredibly, incredibly difficult and unrealistic for anybody, really. And the ego says, well, maybe a few, you know, have done it, but for you, you know, come on, let's be realistic. Don't be pretentious. Who are you to do that? So we keep then saying, okay, I'll settle for something less. Let me see if I can reach some kind of, you know, calm, inner peace, om, 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 you know. And we do the spirituality, the dance of spirituality, never even trying to see, you know, this perfect stalemate, never even try. The ones that succeed are the ones that just tried, actually. They just said, you know what, I think I'm going to try this. And then, boom, they got it. The difficulty is in dispelling all the lies of the ego. It's not in the state itself. Because they always say it's effortless, it's easy, it's simple, you know, just try it. But the ego is desperately trying to convince us that we'll lose our mind, we'll be dead, we'll suffer internal frustration, this frustration will cause a chaotic mind, and all this stuff is telling us, you know, this is how you're going to react to it. So you're not ready for that. You haven't developed the, you know, all this nonsense. It's all nonsense. Now, the ego may be reacting crazy to it, but fine. But you see that the plenum is not being affected by any of that. The ego might go chaotically or whatever, maybe. I don't know. But you just look and say, but the plenum is not affecting it at all. No effect whatsoever. And then you just say, wonderful, amazing. Just love it. Just abiding in this fact. And so you're in bliss. You're not in chaos. So you really don't need a resume. You don't need a spiritual resume. Because the ego loves to pin medals on your chest, saying you've done this and this and this and this, and then you get into collecting merit badges. I want to be an Eagle Scout. I want to get all the merit badges, except one. The ego says, that one, that's got to be the last one. No, it should be the first one. Forget about all the others. It's the personality that's trying to attain enlightenment. It's the ego that's trying. The ego is trying to attain enlightenment, actually. It's not us, not spirit. It's the ego that is sponsoring and trying to attain enlightenment. So forget about enlightenment. We don't need it. We need this perfect stalemate. That's what we need. We don't need enlightenment. Personality doesn't need to be enlightened. The ego doesn't need to be enlightened. What's enlightenment? We don't need it. It's nonsense. We simply need to see a fact, this fact, that here is all this dance of impermanence, and yet it's not affecting what we, this steady state of this plenum of that is not going into any formations at all. Calm, the super calm, total peaceful, unmoving type, you know, plenum. Is not affecting it in any way, shape, or form. That's what we need to see. We need to say, hey, that reminds me of something. Now the ego may say, oh, I got enlightenment or something, whatever. But of course, that will change. You know, enlightenment's a change. And then it'll say, well, I got a bit higher enlightenment. And you get caught up in these changes. And that's not the point. What you're seeing is change of whatever type, and then no change, and seeing both. No change of any type, and change of every type. And the ego, again, will say, well, I've got a higher enlightenment. Now I got to pay attention. I got even bigger enlightenment. And I'm going through all these states and change. That is meaningless to what we need. What we need to say is, whatever change, do whatever you want to, dance however you want to, and call it whatever you want, ego, whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. I'm just seeing the fact that the unchanging is not being changed by whatever you say or claim you're doing, whatever. It's not changing. So this talk is calming me down, actually. It is calming me down. So when I go away from this subject matter, that's when I get hit hard. And if the ego wants to say you're God, say what? Fine, ego, say whatever you want. It's not changing this unchanging. Steady state. It's not changing that at all. Doesn't change it. But if you want to claim I'm not God, that doesn't change it either. Make any claims. Ego will make all these claims, you know. And you might think, oh my gosh, I better tell ego, don't make that claim. It might disturb it. No. Let the ego make claims about what you are. The ego will say, oh, you must be Christ, you must be Jesus, you must be God. And then it says, no, you must be the devil, you must be Satan, you must be this. Let it say whatever it wants to say. All whatever the ego wants to say is equally welcome. Just see, it's not changing anything. Not changing this perfect no. It's not changing the perfect no. So we see that imagination doesn't. It mirrors that imagination doesn't change reality. See, it's a mirroring of that. Without attacking imagination, without getting rid of it, it says, sure, you know, because we are spirit, we're the Son of God, we are imagining. So God is not attacking what we do. He's saying, just showing you, look, imagination doesn't change reality. So there's no continuity problem, really. You just have to see that. afraid to stop taping because it's more than anxiety. It's some kind of, hard to explain. It just literally, I call it the jitters, severe jitters. And my body's just vibrating, everything just vibrating with jitters. Maybe it's the ego saying, look how I can change. You know, I can make everything unstable. Probably getting bit by mosquitoes. Oh, wow. Maybe not. Supposed to get really windy here. Wednesday and Thursday, very windy, blustery wind. They're trying to finish the America's Cup races before Wednesday, for Thursday maybe. I'm not sure what the days are, but before it gets real too windy to race. Yeah, changes. See, in the world, everything's changes. First, New Zealand's up ahead now. Oracle's coming. Team USA is coming back, and you know, we have a very, very tight race going on. The winds will come, atmosphere changes, weather changes, everything changes. But we need to see that which is not changed by all this changefulness. And the Holy Spirit is that. The Holy Spirit presents this for us. It has this in our mind, presents that which is unchanged by all the changefulness. Now, traditionally, they make the analogy of waves on an ocean, okay? But it's, I would say it's probably not quite like that. That's an analogy. Again, I would say like a still lake, and then there's a lake with all these, you know, chop on it. Windy lake that's all tossing and, you know, turmoil. And you see, but the turmoil of this one lake doesn't affect the turmoil of the other at all. And they're like side by side, right together, so to speak. Over one, it's something like that. But, you know, you can understand the analogy of the ocean and the waves, how the waves don't really change the nature of the ocean. But I'm just putting a little clearer emphasis on the whole situation, actually. And remember, the ego does everything it can to sponsor all spiritual teaching on this planet. Does everything it can just to turn us away from. Jesus said, go sell all your fancy jewelry and get the pearl of great price. What is he saying? He means drop all your spiritual practices and just do this one thing. Okay, see what the Holy Spirit has for us, and see this perfect no, which we see as a perfect stalemate. Just do that, and turn in all your jewelry, because we have all this fancy jewelry that's like, oh yeah, you know, this is our spiritual resume, all this stuff that we're thinking is really, really fancy and really amazing. Nah, just, you know, it's junk. It's the ego telling you that it's effective when it's not. We can get in all sorts of states of mind, as it were, but that's not effective to solve the continuity problem. Someone might go into meditation for 50 years and come out, and they still have the continuity problem. Is still there. It hasn't gone anywhere. So, you know, what's the use? And of course, this all may sound heretical to the ego. It is, of course, because I'm saying something that against the ego's training program and all everything it's sponsoring, which it claims is, you know, all important, which it isn't. No importance at all. And again, the ego says, oh, you need all this stuff first. Not really. Not really. We only seem to need it because we believe we need it. And so our beliefs are so strong, we do seem like we have to work through this stuff first. But actually, there's something within us that's always telling us, no, we don't really need this. No, it's a waste of time. That's how I've always felt. All this spiritual stuff, I said, don't need it. It's a waste of time. But just for the sake of trying to appear that, you know, pure spiritual, we go through, jump all through these hoops to say, hey, I can jump through this hoop and this one and this one and this one and this one and waste all this time. So pretty much I've stayed away from all spiritual aspirants in the world because I don't want to try to prove anything to them, you know. I can do this, I can do that, I don't want to waste time on that. I'm trying to say, no, you don't need to do that. It's breathing, exit, whatever. There's endless variety of stuff. None of that's really necessary. It's because none of it's effective. And we say, well, we can only do the ultimate when we do all the other stuff first. The ultimate is just pure pragmatism, you know. It's not the ultimate in the sense of difficulty. So it's not right to talk of it in terms of ultimate, because all the other stuff doesn't work, and this does work. So it's more just a pass-fail kind of thing instead of the ultimate, because saying the ultimate makes it seem like the other stuff is really good too, but not quite as good. That's nonsense. It's nonsense. The other stuff doesn't work, and the perfect no, which we see as the perfect stalemate, does work. So it's just simply pragmatism. It's not a question of the ultimate. It just works. It's what works. The ego will tell us, there's nothing there. You know, you're going out in the desert, there's nothing there. Well, good. There's no formations in this. So how come, ego, you can't make any formations in this? What's your problem? Why can't you bring what you call life to the desert, so to speak? What's your problem? The problem is you can't. Because this was created by God for us. See, you cannot overcome God for us. You cannot do it. I see that you can't do it. And the ego says, I'll figure a way out. I say, well, you know, if you have the power, right, you know, you could show it right now. How come you don't have the power now? You don't have the power now. Why don't you have the power now? Let's talk about that. Let's not talk about the future. Let's talk about now. Why can't you do it now? You see? Where did your weakness come from? Huh? Where did your weakness come from? So you have the power of the now over the ego, so to speak, at that point. And you can say, let's talk about now, because you can't do it now. See, that puts you in the driver's seat. It puts the ego on the defensive. And then gradually or quickly you begin to press this advantage on the ego. And the ego's position becomes weaker and weaker and weaker, and just, you know, dissolves away. You realize it doesn't have a position. It can't. And you just enjoy this fact. The ego will say, well, I'm going to find a way. And then I would say, well, how come you don't have the way now? Someone take it away from you? Who took it away from you? Why are you? You were born incapable? We're seeing the fact right now that there is this capability of not being changed, you know? And it just the ego, it causes it to not be able to really press its advantage anymore. And you can say, well, I can see you can't do it now, and that's reminding me of something, really a powerful reminder of something. That actually, I was just trying to change reality, but I realize I can't. That's what's reminding me of. It's reminding me of that, and the reality can't be changed. That's what I'm being reminded of. So, it's kind of like a mirror, and what's appearing in the mirror, insisting that it can change the mirror by dancing in front of the mirror. That's another way of looking at it. Let's say it's a mirror. Okay, the Holy Spirit provides with a mirror. And so the ego says, I can dance, you know, all these dances, the boogaloo, you know, the fish, the boogaloo, the, I don't know, a lot of dances. The bony maroney, there's a million dances. And the ego will do all these dances in front of the mirror and says, I'm gonna change you, mirror. I'm gonna change you, mirror. Look what I'm doing now. I'm dancing differently. Ah, I'm changing you, mirror. But you're looking in the mirror, says, no, the mirror's unchanged, ego. You're not changing the mirror. So you've made all these boasts and none of them have been true. So when you say, well, you're gonna find a way, well, first we have to look at the fact you've been lying about this. So, you know, now, I mean, we may want the ego to be able to change the mirror, but I think the more we look at the fact that it's not, the more we can, you know, our fear diminishes of the continuity issue, then the easier it is to dispel the ego's nonsense. But that's a good analogy. If you're watching this screen on your computer, you know, to see if something changes the screen, you're gonna change the screen, and is it changing? You know, anything happening to the screen? Is it? It's still the same. I haven't been able to change it. Let me grab a screen. Whoops! You know, nothing happened to it. Still there. I'm gonna change you, screen. I'm gonna change you, screen. Abracadabra. Poof! Changed it. The ego say, it's all changed. Oh, I'm changed. I'm changed. Look at this. It'll put on a wig or something. Look, I'm changed. It changed me so much. Well, it didn't change the mirror. It might change the dance. What's dancing? What's being reflected in the mirror? But it didn't change the mirror itself at all. And then the ego might even get a mirror of its own and shatter the mirror, you know, shatter the mirror and say, ah, see, I broke the mirror. I might take a computer screen and you know, tear the computer screen or something and you say, you see, there's the torn screen. I told you I could do it. And yet you're still looking at on your screen. There's no tear at all on your screen. So that's the madness of the ego. But it, you know, we kind of get a kick out of his antics. Stand up with a little guy, you know, like, hey, this cute little kid doing all these funny antics, and you know, but this jitteriness and fear is no, it's not funny. It's not funny at all. So the plenum can be seen like as a mirror, unchanging mirror. The ego throw something on it, you know, throw ink on it, and pretend to, you know, throw ink, but again, nothing's happening to the mirror. And then we're not the mirror, we're observing this. Some might say, just be the mirror. You know, no, we're observing the ego and the mirror and what the ego's claiming about the mirror. And we're seeing that the mirror's not changing, the ego's insisting that its antics mean that the mirror is being changed. The ego says there's meaning in what it's doing. It says, this, abracadabra, poof, that means the mirror's changed. The ego says, see, I changed it. I changed the meaning of the mirror. And then you have to realize, did not. The meaning of the mirror is that what the ego does doesn't change it. So you just simply notice this fact that the mirror is not changed. So that's the meaning of the mirror. But the ego will go off and say, I changed the mirror. I changed the mirror, everybody. Hey, guess what? I changed the mirror. We'll tell everybody that. And people say, really? How'd you do that? And the ego says, I'll tell you. I'll set up a mystery school and we'll talk about how we can change the mirror. The ego didn't change the mirror. It just claimed that it did. So whatever is dancing in front of the mirror, it's not changing the mirror. And we're noticing that. We just notice it. We are that which is noticing the facts. We notice the facts of the situation. Objective, what are the facts? Just stick with the facts. Let the ego say, well, I'm gonna, I don't need to keep dancing because I've already changed the mirror, so that's it. And say that. The reason, they'll stop, the reason the ego's pretend to stop. Say, oh, okay, it's finished, it's all finished. I changed it, done. That's another trick. So it'll like thinking that by ignoring the mirror, it's changing the mirror. It's like, I already changed the mirror, you just don't know it yet. Or the observer hasn't yet realized that fact, and then you just realize the fact, it has not changed it. And again, you don't have to convince the ego of anything, because it'll keep throwing these tricks up, you know, saying, but by ignoring it, it's changing it. And then it'll come back and say, have you realized that you've been changed yet? No? Oh, okay, I'll go ignore you for a long time again until you realize that. Say, well, take your time. There's no hurry. Because all the while, we are experiencing the perfection of the stalemate, and that reminds us of reality. So however the ego wants to play it, it's okay. It wants to engage and dance, or it wants to say, no, I don't need to dance. You just can't accept the fact I already changed it, so we're going to wait for you. It can do that too. Whatever it wants to do, it doesn't matter. But these are the kinds of consideration that a responsible spirit and mind will engage in. That's culture. No excuses. We have a problem, we have a continuity problem. Making excuses about it, it doesn't work. So we have to focus in on the problem. That is the activity of life. Now, I get depressed when I see everybody doing all this other stuff and I'm not doing any of that. I figure, wow, maybe I'm missing life, you know, because I've only spent my life focusing on this issue. And very little else, really. Just put everything else in the background. Just say, forget it. It's not important enough to do, really. No, I want to go up to the Giants game, maybe Wednesday, but will I go? No. Very tempting, but I said, no, you know, forget it. It's not that important. It's not that important. Want to go to the America's Cup? Will I do it? No. I could have done all this stuff. I said, you know what? It's not that important. This is what's important. So just don't do it. And that's a life. A life is established by what you don't do, really. Just as much as what you do, what you don't do. Because people will do all this stuff, do, and then they're in a retirement home, and then they're feeble, and then they die. And what do they do, really? Nothing. I mean, did they do anything that needed to be done? No. They just wasted their time. And that's their life. That was their life. That life, that particular life cycle, wasted their time. I mean, they may have gotten a lot of applause from others for doing that, but within, there's no applause within, because the ego is still, the continuity problem is still there, and the ego is still intimidating them. So, again, a responsible culture is not engaged in all this wasteful activities. They won't. It will seem to be quite a pretty simple situation, really. Very simple. Not all sophisticated, not all complex. All that stuff is just distractions. Those are just distractions. We don't really look on YouTube, look at the internet, look on magazines. You know, you see the stuff that people are doing, it just boggles my mind, completely boggles my mind. I mean, I cannot even conceive of doing any of that stuff. Because I know this problem, this situation is there and remains unresolved. I still have to keep working at it. Pleasant diversion is not going to solve the situation. It just doesn't. People might say, well, why don't you go do something, get your mind off of it? Nah, it doesn't work that way. You got to get your mind on it. You got to get on it and you know, really get into it. Sri Nisargadatta, he says he did it in 3 years. Did he do it in 3 years? Sure. Why? Because he just trusted his guru, and the guru says, do this, and he just did that. That's it. And it worked, you see, because he turned his attention to what works. Now, he has a different way of explaining it, but that's just cultural, from, you know, different background and all this kind of stuff. But he's saying, you know, much similar stuff, but 3 years. Because there was a culture there in place that had been in place for a long time, that trusted the guru, that trusted those who'd also done it, and they say, just do this. Didn't say do all this other stuff. His guru said, just do this one thing, and he did it, and he said rapidly, he had rapid success. Because yeah, that's a perfect example. And he had the open-eyed samadhi. As I said, he just acted like a normal person, but all the while he was seeing this immutable plenum, as it were, there all the time, not being touched by the antics of his personality. So he wasn't trying to constrain his personality to keep from changing the plenum. He says, no, whatever, I just live my life and sell cigarettes, whatever, it doesn't touch this plenum at all, this immutableness at all. It's not touched by it. So, yeah. He got it quick, but that's a rarity. But that's possible in a correct culture. Very possible for that to happen, because you don't waste your time with all the ego's antics. You just do the one thing that you're able to focus your attention, you know, where it needs to be, without wasting time. But in this culture here, oh, now we are, it's just like the ego is just dredging up so much spirituality stuff. It's just unbelievable delay. That's why that this fourth dimensional cycle is so terrible. So much stuff. You can get lost into it. You just go into a New Age bookstore or something and just say, oh my God, what in the world, you know? I could spend lifetimes in here and I still wouldn't have hardly gotten anywhere. It's just, you know, it's like the fourth dimension. You'll spend a lot of time there, you know, tripping through states of mind, and then, you know, what a long, strange trip it's been, and you'll still have a lot of more long, strange trip it's been, and you'll be on that merry prankster bus, you know, further, and you'll keep going further and further and further, and still, the continuity problem hasn't even been touched, and something in the back of your mind says, I've done all this stuff, and I haven't gotten anywhere. But the fourth dimensional cycle can keep you going around in a spiritual Disneyland for a long, long time, going on all these different rides. And after each ride, you say, wow, I did that ride. Now, where's the next ride? And just go from one to the other to the other. That's the danger of it. Very dangerous cycle that we're headed towards. Because the variety of delay is just, you know, exponentially faster. So much variety of delay. You know, visiting other planets, people be visiting other planets, other cultures, and just doing all this stuff, and it's just, again, not touching on the problem at all, which is to see that all of the dance of energy doesn't change this undancing energy. at all. Just noticing that fact. That is what has to be noticed. So it doesn't matter how you dance or how long you dance. That's not the issue. It's not the issue at all. It leaves the continuity problem totally unsolved. Doesn't do anything to solve it. It doesn't matter where you go, what you do. Doesn't matter. It leaves it unsolved. So you can have a cigarette salesman in Bombay, and in a little house there, and he can get it. He sees it. He sees the dance, the permanence. Sees the immutable. It's not affecting the immutable at all. That continuity problem solved there. Just right there. Doesn't have to be, you know, tripping out on some long, strange trip. Doesn't have to be dancing, you know, in some dance. He says, whatever the dance, it doesn't matter. Whatever the dance you have, just use that, and you can see it doesn't affect, you know, doesn't affect at all the undancing, that which doesn't dance. And it's funny, when I'm growing up, I always refused to dance. I still do. Although, you know, at times I'm forced to just dance a little bit. But really, for me, I'd say, I don't want to dance. I have no desire to dance whatsoever. Let's see the undancing, that which doesn't dance at all. Can't be pulled into dance. You get the beautiful Maya says, come on, let's dance. And you're just watching. Don't intervene, just watch, see what happens. Can the ego get the Holy Spirit to dance with the ego? No, cannot. And the ego puts on many guises, yet the beautiful goddess and the goddess of dancing. Holy Spirit, look at me. Let's dance. Come on. It'll be so wonderful. What a thrill. Let's trip the light fantastic. Come on. We'll dance a universe into being. Come on, let's dance. Holy Spirit just sits there. No dancing. This is the perfect non-dancer. Can't do it. So you just notice that. You don't intervene. Don't officiate between the two. See, that's the thing. Have faith in the Holy Spirit. Don't jump up and say, whoa, I'll dance with you. I mean, I'm afraid the Holy Spirit might get seduced by you, so I don't want that to happen, so I want to give it time to think about it, but I'll dance. No, don't do that. Then you're gone. And that's actually what the ego's trying to do. It's trying to get you to intervene. It's trying to get you to jump up and save the Holy Spirit, you know, save the vibe, and give it time to develop some more defenses against this. But it's really your own lack of defensiveness against it that you're projecting onto the Holy Spirit and thinking that it's there where it's not. So you have to refuse to act on those projections. And just say, let's see what happens here. And of course, the goddess of the dance will dance off by yourself saying, you're no fun, and maybe later, you say, the Holy Spirit did not dance. So these are the kind of recognitions that are required to soften loosen the whole situation up, so it doesn't become some kind of mind-boggling, you know, overwhelming, and then it shifts into panic mode, where we think it's too much, we cannot even think about it. Now we can definitely think about it and look at these factors of just like, don't project your own lack of resistance onto the Holy Spirit and think you need to intervene. Let the two, you know, let the dancer try to get the Holy Spirit to dance. Just watch it. Just sit back and watch. It's a movie, but just sit back and watch. And we should say, whatever does dance is not the Holy Spirit. So, you know, you may see something where the ego symbolizes the Holy Spirit and then gets that to dance, but just tell yourself, no, that's not the Holy Spirit then. If there's something dancing, it's not the Holy Spirit. So again, is it possible to have a culture of emphasis on this? Well, of course it is. Absolutely. We're doing it right now. It's no big deal, as a matter of fact. It's very doable. So again, we're not trying to say that we won't dance. We're not making any claims for ourselves. We're just seeing if the dance, the goddess can get the Holy Spirit to dance. That not can the goddess get us to dance? Well, of course, but that's not the point of the whole thing. We're saying, can it get the Holy Spirit to dance? That's what we're interested in. So we change our interest, and we'll just say, no, you go get that Holy Spirit to dance. Let's see how you do there. I know you can get me to dance, but let's see if you can get the Holy Spirit to dance. That's the thing. And then you notice they can't, they cannot. Stalemate. And the goddess will say, I'll keep on trying. I'm going to keep trying. I'm going to get you. Holy Spirit just doesn't say anything. Just, it's unmoved. The Holy Spirit doesn't say, hey, help me out. I need help. No. So, just hearing all this, just you realize, you know what? It's possible. We can talk. These things can be talked about easily. It's not difficult. And there's no call to action. You know, I'm not called to some kind of immediate action. We just let it sink in and say, that's not so difficult. That's not really that difficult. And then next time, you can go further and you say, that wasn't so difficult. And then further, that's not so difficult. Well, so difficult. And gradually, what the ego said wasn't like, you know, just completely out of your reach. You say, no, that's easy. It was right within reach. It's not difficult at all. And then there you are. So it's just a matter of practicing. It's just a matter of hearing, listening, and realizing that you can hear it. You're listening. Your own listening is aware of it. You have the capacity to do it. And it gradually gets easier and easier and easier until these, you know, real pivotal issues can be just looked at directly and just say, oh, okay, this is a pivotal issue, and we can pivot here like that, and okay, this is the ego, say this and that, and then, okay, you know, that's pretty clear. It's very, very clear. It's not all confusing or anything, really. And again, it's all a matter of just actually trying it. We don't try. We don't even try it. And we define that as meaning it must be difficult. Not true. The Sagradatta said it's not difficult. If you try. It's getting to the trying point which is difficult, because the ego has tricked us so badly. But the more we see its tricks, the closer we get to actually trying. Say, okay, let me just try to observe. Just an observer and not a participant. I'm just an observer. Maybe that's what people say when just be the observer. Maybe that's what they're saying. Is you're not a, let the Holy Spirit and the ego interact, as it were. You just be the observer. Accept the role of the observer. So that's a good way to put it. Accept the role of the observer. You're simply an observer. You're watching a movie. You didn't produce the movie. You didn't do anything. You're just watching it. Accept that role. And just like on a movie screen, when the actors are engaged in something, and you say, oh, look out, you know, you want to jump up, but you realize it's a screen, you can't do anything about it. Just make it like that, like you're just watching a screen, and you can't, you know, jump in between the Holy Spirit and the ego. Let the play, you know, play out. See what happens, see what the ego does. The ego will have all the drama, all the histrionics, all the antics. You remember, You've ever seen this, something like Make Me Laugh type of thing, where they have a comedian and they get members of the audience and they say, okay, $100, if you can keep from laughing, I'm gonna make you laugh. And of course that, I like that. I like to watch that. It's like, okay, and the comedian will, you know, try and do all these antics, and the person is saying, you know, I'm not gonna laugh. Not laughing like that. And then the comedian is saying, come on, you can do better than that. Don't laugh. You're not doing good enough. More serious, come on. and then gradually the comedian breaks him into laughter most of the time, you know. And you're just observing. You're just the audience observing. It's kind of like that. Think of it like that. Make me laugh. And we're just audience members. And the ego's trying to get the Holy Spirit to laugh. Or you might say it's trying to get the Holy Spirit to stop laughing. You know, maybe that's more accurate. The Holy Spirit maybe is just one big laugh, one perfect laugh at the ego. You know, it's laughable. What you're trying to do, ego, to die, is laughable. So the ego says, I'm going to make you stop laughing. And the Holy Spirit just keeps right on laughing. Yeah, that's what it's like. So, for watching the show, I'm going to make you stop laughing. And the ego says, no bad. How can you laugh at me? You know, this is serious stuff I'm doing here. And the Holy Spirit just keeps laughing. All right, so then we can laugh along with it. Eventually we learn to laugh along with the Holy Spirit. Absolutely. And this inner laughter is like bliss, inner laughter. But we're just observing this. We're audience members, as it were. Make me not laugh. I'm going to make you not laugh. The ego says, come on up, Holy Spirit. I'm going to make you stop laughing. Has it? And it tries all sorts of tricks. Can't do it. So we just watch it. It's like a comedy show, really. So just watch it. It's like a comedy show. All this tragedy. Are you getting the Holy Spirit to not laugh yet? No, it's still laughing. Well, I'm gonna start a war. No, it's still laughing. I'm gonna kill everybody. Still laughing. I'm gonna get everybody sick. Still laughing. Everybody's gonna die, you know. No. I'm gonna make life miserable. Still laughing. I'm gonna bring death upon everything. Still laughing, you know. So the ego just hurls all these threats at the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's still laughing. And the ego says, what do I do? I don't know what to do. This would be fun to watch. So this is an interesting way to look at it, right? We're reframing the whole situation into a comedy show. Now we've reached the point where we're saying, it's a comedy show we're watching. We're going to watch a comedy, a great comedy, best comedy ever. Stop Me From Laughing, starring the ego and the Holy Spirit. And we're just watching it. And as long as the Holy Spirit's laughing, we're laughing along with it. You know, we say, hey, it's still laughing. You haven't succeeded yet, ego. Keep on trying. And it's fun. It's fun for us. And all the while, the continuity problem is being resolved within us. And yet we can spend our time laughing and bliss. It's funny. But the meta message is the continuity problem is actually getting resolved. But we don't have to be directly focused on that. We don't say, oh yeah, is it being resolved yet? No. We're laughing along with the Holy Spirit and saying, hey, this is pretty cool. The ego can't keep the Holy Spirit from laughing. So, and the ego says, you can't talk about spiritual stuff like it's a comedy show. That's blasphemous. And I say, Holy Spirit's still laughing. Didn't stop it, keep it from laughing by saying that. Holy Spirit, the ego say, you're blasphemous. You're absolutely, terrible. And the Holy Spirit's still laughing. And the yogi is fuming, fuming mad. It's gonna stop. I'm fuming mad at you, Holy Spirit. We're still laughing. See it that way. See it that way. Yeah. See what happens to this. This might be a way to reframe the whole situation where it might just actually start happening. We might start seeing it. We might start seeing it. Thinking outside the box here, right? The ego doesn't want you to think outside the box. It doesn't want you to get the show started. Say, ego, I decided you're going to star in a show with the Holy Spirit. The ego says, no, 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 no. How can I do that? I'm busy meditating, or I'm busy being spiritual. No, I want you to star in a comedy show with the Holy Spirit. It's called Make Me Stop Laughing. Holy Spirit's going to be laughing. You're going to try to stop it from laughing. So that's the new show I'm going to watch. See what happens. See if you can do it. So maybe this will work. I was thinking outside the box of the ego. The ego wants to frame it the way it wants to frame it. You know, the ego's always trying to frame things the way it wants it to be framed. And insisting anyone who doesn't do that is the devil, is just terrible, oh, awful. No, but we have the right to reframe it. Absolutely. The ego's actually our servant. It's just the mind pretending to, you know, to, it's just the mind presenting an idea to us. So it's our servant. So if we tell the mind, guess what, mind, you're now going to star in a comedy show. Because I want you to. Because that's what I want now, is I want you to star in a comedy show with the Holy Spirit. So that's the new idea. I've always said, choose a new idea. Okay, let's make it more specific. Choose the idea, say, you want the ego to star in a comedy show. The mind is starring with the Holy Spirit in this comedy show. Make me stop laughing. Take away my bliss. That's the take away my bliss. And the mind, you gotta try to take away the bliss of the Holy Spirit. Ah. So then we just watch that. All right. We'll see, maybe this will work. Maybe this will work. It seems to be, you know, evolving in the right direction, as it were, right now. Well, let's get on a plane, and on the plane we'll have this live show, a live comedy show, the ego and the Holy Spirit, and they'll entertain us on the flight. The ego trying to get the Holy Spirit to stop its laughter. Or make me dance. The Holy Spirit's there sitting in a chair, and the goddess comes and says, I'm going to make you dance. Make me dance. And the ego, no, I'm not dancing. And she does, you know, a million tricks, clever tricks. And we just watch it there and says, ah, this is very entertaining. And the upshot is, cannot get the Holy Spirit to dance. So that's, I mean, we're taking this flight and this in-flight entertainment, and we get the continuity problem solved for us. So it can be very enjoyable like this, actually, when we put it this way. Say, this is what we want. This is what we want now. We don't need all this, the ego acting out this world, showing, boasting what it can do. We want to see what the ego can do, the Holy Spirit. See, it's a different, whole different thing, isn't it? Entirely. So you don't need a world then, do you? Not really. You can have a flawless, perfect world, but you can have just a stage and put the ego and the Holy Spirit on the stage and say, okay, let's see, entertain us. Let's see what's going to happen here. Because the ego's bragging this world, look what I can do, all this death, all this suffering. I say, well, it doesn't matter anymore. Because what I wanted you to do now, because you've got all this practice, is now time, put up or shut up time. You've had all this practice. I'm not giving you any more time to practice, ego. You now have to make the Holy Spirit stop laughing, okay? Go. You're on stage. You're on camera now. That's the new mandate I've given you. Like that, okay? So all this bad stuff that's happening in your life, etc., that comes to an end. Because that's the Holy Spirit just in training. The ego. That is the ego in training. You're giving it time to train, learning all the suffering, misery, complaints. And it's going to go to the Holy Spirit and complain. I was living here and this happened to me and that happened to me and you didn't do anything, you didn't help me and blah, 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 blah. You know, so when you start hearing all this inner complaints, just say, don't tell it to me, tell it to the Holy Spirit. Let's see if you can keep it from laughing. That's what I want to find out now. Whole shift like that. Total shift, right, in what's going on in your life. Complete shift. Today, the ego was complaining severely. I was, the personality was super complaining. Holy Spirit's never done anything. Hasn't helped me at all, blah. And finally, I said, you know what? It sounds like you're just, trying to, practice because you're about ready to meet the Holy Spirit. So you're trying to get all your complaints lined up so you can have really good effort, you know. Or it's maybe all your complaints are going to soon be over, and so you're just trying to get your last complaints in. But more like the ego is just trying to get all its complaints ready so it can show me, that it can get the Holy Spirit. It's going to get the Holy Spirit to drop its laughter. You never did anything. You never helped him. You never did any blah, 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 blah. Well, the fact that I've gotten to this point where I decided to change the idea and have the ego and the Holy Spirit interact, it got me to that point, didn't it? Ego can't say much about that, can it? No, it can't. That's the whole point the Holy Spirit trying to get us to, is let the ego and the Holy Spirit go at it and get us out of the way. So if it gets you to that point, it did its job. It absolutely did its job. So when the ego is bad mouthing the Holy Spirit, say, don't tell it to me. Don't tell it to the Holy Spirit. Don't tell it to me. I'm going to change your... I'm not going to listen to you anymore. You have to now interact with the Holy Spirit directly. Let's go one-on-one. Let's see. Let's see who the winner is. And the ego says, uh-oh. That's in trouble. I need more training. I said, no, you've had enough training. I've decided that's enough. Enough's enough. I need more training and I'm suffering. Let's see. I want to see how you stack up right now. I've given you enough training. If you're saying you need more training, you're admitting you can't do it. But besides, I want to be entertained. So I don't care whether you say you need more training. I think it's going to be quite entertaining the way it is. Because you got no choice but to try. And I want to be entertained that way now. Because that will solve the continuity problem for me. So, and I'm sure the laughter of the Holy Spirit will irritate the ego plenty. So it will certainly make any and all efforts to get it to stop laughing. No doubt about it. And as long as the continuity problem's there, of course it will. And then gradually the continuity problem, as the ego fails, the continuity problem melts away. So, yeah. Complete reframing of the whole situation is taking place here, which is what is necessary. That's the real work. That is the true work. So if the ego keeps complaining, hey, Holy Spirit's done nothing. I said, yes, it brought me to the point where I've now cast you in a different role, that you're going one-on-one with the Holy Spirit. It got me to that point. So complain about to the Holy Spirit now. I'm out of the loop now. I'm just an observer. I'm just watching. This is entertainment for me now. Completely, it changes everything. Which is necessary. Because the ego's getting very uppity in the world right now. That is for sure. It's saying, I need a whole nother cycle of training. Well, you're not in charge, Ego. I need entertainment at this point. I'm tired of these cycles of your training. So I want to be entertained. So I want to see you go up against the Holy Spirit. That's what you're going to do now. Ah, but I'm not ready for it. Well, tell that to the Holy Spirit. Maybe they'll stop laughing. Let's find out. Make your complaints there, not to me. All right. Very great. This is good stuff. Necessary stuff. It's pushed back the anxiety. You know, it's pushed it back. Because we certainly, I think the anxiety has to do with being sucked into another cycle, you know. Another training cycle for the ego, another training cycle. What's it going to be? Death, misery, suffering, more complaints. The ego wants to generate some ultimate complaint against the Holy Spirit so that it can, what it wants to say is, Holy Spirit, you never helped them at all. You never did anything. And it hopes that then the Holy Spirit will stop laughing. But remember, when the Holy Spirit gets us to pit the ego against the Holy Spirit, that's its goal. So it did do something. It did what it needed to do. Amazing resolution of this dilemma. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.